Hello, welcome to another World History lesson. Today we're going to be covering the Renaissance and the Reformation. To start with, we're going to be covering the Italian Renaissance. We're going to move forward with the Northern Renaissance, and then we're going to be talking about the Reformation, beginning with Lutheranism, then the English Reformation, the Reformation in Switzerland, and the Catholic Reformation or the Counter-Reformation. In terms of the historical background for the Renaissance, we have non-Western empires thriving across the world, both in Africa and in the Americas. The Black Plague had decimated Europe. The Roman Catholic Church has absolute power over both knowledge and society, and also politics across Europe. And people are barely making it out of the Middle Ages. They're trying to redefine what it means to be a person. So when we talk about the Italian Renaissance, we have to talk about the word Renaissance itself. It comes from the meaning of rebirth. And so we're going to be seeing the revival of art and literature under the influence of classical Greco-Roman models in the 14th and 16th centuries. So again, we're going to be taking elements from Greek times, from Roman times, and applying new ideas to actually try to understand what it means to be human during that time. We're going to be talking about the Italian Renaissance. This is where the Renaissance begins because, again, we have the Greeks and the Romans being a part of that same geographic location. And we're going to have multiple Italian city-states as a key source of political and social structure within this Renaissance period. And so the biggest city-state that is still known today is Vatican City. However, we do have the Republic of Venice, with Venice being a cultural center and Florence being also another cultural center during that time as well. Here's the history of the Medici family.
The Medicis are one of the most influential and controversial families in the history of the world. They used the power of their wealth to rise above all the other upper-class families of Florence to dominate the political and cultural scene. The Medicis were instrumental in the rise of the Italian Renaissance and were deeply involved in shaping European culture and politics for 300 years. But after so many years of dominance, the House of Medici fell as quickly as it rose. Today, we're taking an in-depth look at the rise and fall of the Medici family. But first, here's some background. Who were the Medici family? In the 14th century, the Medicis rose from relative obscurity to become the most powerful and wealthiest family in all of Italy and most of Europe. They were an Italian banking family, political dynasty, and royal house that became dominant in the early 15th century. The Medicis used the wealth from their hugely successful bank to wield influence over the political and cultural scene in Florence, Italy, and beyond. The House of Medici is now counted among the most influential families in the history of the world. They helped launch the Renaissance period in Florence and made an impact that continues to be felt even today. The Medicis were the first to win their ruling status through commerce rather than through warfare, marriage, or inheritance. But how did it all start? Beginnings. The Medici family moved from the Tuscan hillside to Florence in present-day Italy at some point in the 12th century and became established members of the community. As a prominent banking family, the Medicis were wealthy members of the upper class, even before they became one of the most influential families in Europe. The story of the Medici family's incredible rise in Florence starts with Giovanni de' Medici. Giovanni rose through the ranks of the Florentine banking system until he became the manager of his uncle's bank in Rome. When his uncle retired, he left the bank in Giovanni's hands. Later on, Giovanni moved to Florence and officially established the Medici Bank. The bank soon became the top financial institution in the region, largely thanks to their primary clients, the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church. Other branches were opened up in Rome, Geneva, and Venice, but this was just the beginning. The rise. Giovanni passed the banking business on to his sons, Cosimo and Lorenzo, who were the two main founders of the famous Medici bloodlines. During the 1430s, Cosimo began to use the incredible wealth at his disposal to set up an elaborate network in Florence, which greatly increased his influence. He was quick to loan money in exchange for favors, and within just a few years, nearly every business in Florence was beholden to him. Cosimo spread the Medici Bank throughout Western Europe and beyond, opening branches in Milan, London, Pisa, Barcelona, Cairo, and other cities. The money from all of these cities flowed directly into the House of Medici through the Medici Bank. The Pope opened a significant line of credit, giving the Medicis control over the church's purse strings as well. With all of his power and influence, Cosimo became the de facto ruler of Florence, even though officially he remained a private citizen, and the House of Medici became the dominant family in Florence. Cosimo was able to maintain control by buying the votes of office holders. The families that had been dominant before this were not happy about Cosimo's quick rise to power. A rival family had him arrested and exiled, but Cosimo's political network and bribe money soon helped him to wipe out his enemies. Once all opposition was removed, Cosimo returned to Florence and ruled nearly unchecked for 30 years. During this time, Cosimo poured money into the arts and cultural pursuits, which made him and the Medici family very popular. Cosimo was also able to use the arts to his political advantage by sponsoring propaganda. Before long, Florence was the cultural center of Europe. Under Cosimo's control, the Medici family kept getting richer and richer. At one point, they reportedly owned 27 villas in Florence and Tuscany. But could the family continue thriving after the death of its leader? Loss of wealth, murder, and exile. When Cosimo passed away in 1464, his son Piero took over as Florence's ruler, but died just 5 years later. After his death, the leading citizens of Florence asked Piero's son, Lorenzo, to take on the unofficial ruling role. Lorenzo was only 20 years old and wasn't nearly as effective at running the family bank or using his wealth to silence his opposition. In 1478, a coalition of the Medici family's enemies plotted to take out both Lorenzo and his younger brother, Giuliano. The plan was for the brothers to be killed as they knelt before the altar at a mass at the Cathedral of Florence. Giuliano was killed, but Lorenzo fought his way out, and by nightfall, four of the attackers were hung. Like his grandfather, Lorenzo was known to be a patron of the arts, and a number of notable artists were in his court, including Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, and Sandro Botticelli. In 1471, Lorenzo calculated how much his family had spent on charity, buildings, and artistic support since his grandfather took control. The amount totaled more than $460 million at today's valuation. After Lorenzo's death in 1492, his 20-year-old son Piero became leader of Florence. Much of the family's wealth had been depleted under Lorenzo's rule due to his inattention to the family bank, which officially closed in 1494. So Piero was the first in line of the Medici to attempt to rule without ample wealth to back him up. After giving up several castles and the ports of Pisa and Livorno in an imbalanced peace treaty with France, the angered citizens of Florence forced him out of the city, and he died in exile. A new bloodline. When the male descendants of Cosimo died off, the male heirs of his brother, Lorenzo, took over and began a new branch of the Medici dynasty. Two of Lorenzo's sons became popes in the 16th century, taking the names Leo X and Clement VII. Both of them were the unofficial rulers of Florence and Rome. Pope Leo spent the church's money freely and incurred massive debts. Pope Clement's 11-year reign was a tumultuous time for Italy, and the Republicans in Florence once again tried to remove the Medicis from power. This led to a 3-year struggle, but the Medicis ultimately retained their power, and for the next 200 years, power was passed peacefully through the generations of the Medici family with very little resistance in Florence. The fall of the House of Medici. By the 17th century, the Medici family was faced with a lack of male heirs and was virtually bankrupt. The population of Florence had dropped by half due to diseases and people moving to other areas. The later Medici rulers were more authoritarian and weren't concerned with cultural or artistic endeavors, which led to the decline of Florence as the cultural center of Europe. The last male of the senior branch of the Medicis died in 1737. This brought an end to a nearly 300-year Medici family dynasty, which was replaced by the long-lasting European reign of the Habsburg-Lorraine family. However, their legacy continues to live on even today. The Medici legacy. The most enduring legacy of the Medicis comes through their support of art and architecture. The structures they were responsible for include St. Peter's Basilica and Santa Maria del Fiore. The artists and scientists they sponsored include Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, Raphael, Galileo, and Machiavelli. Their funding led to the creation of opera and the invention of the piano. Their riches supported Florence as the cultural center of the Renaissance and created a cultural awakening that could only be compared to that of the ancient Greeks. For a period of time, they were the wealthiest family in Europe, and their bloodline mixed with royal families throughout the continent due to...
So basically in this video, we see the history of the Medici family. They were the most important family in Italy for over 300 years. And a key figure that you have to remember is Lorenzo de' Medici, because he was one of the most important patrons of art during that time period. Now, the key concept in the Renaissance is Renaissance humanism. The basic ideas are education, having ambition to better yourself, respect towards one another, free will, a specific set of morality that departs from the church but is not necessarily religious, and a lot of curiosity to keep on exploring and learning new things. Its application. We have a lot of people that start doing a self-study in all fields. Leonardo da Vinci is a clear example of this. A lot of exploration of the world. The norming of Christianity and daily norms within the Christian tradition. The rise of secular institutions like banks and governments as well. And a huge focus on what it means to be human. Now, a key term for this chapter is going to be secularism. Secularism is a system of political or social philosophy that rejects all forms of religious faith and worship in addressing a more worldly view. So we, as a Renaissance person, you strive to have this more worldly view and not just be in the confines of a religious state, but rather be able to fulfill your aspirations outside of that religion and outside of that institution. So basically, the role of the state and the church become separate. We see this in a lot of modern governments as well. Now, another key term in this for the Renaissance is going to be patronism. Patronism is a practice or culture in business and society that is based on personal relations. We have patronism in terms of artists, because every single artist out there is not recognized but by his profession. So you would go into an artist workshop and you would ask the artist to actually do something for you. Artists do not have a say into what they're going to be painting, because they need money to survive, and because their only profession is art, they need somebody else to actually pay for those tools, for the canvases, for the paint itself, and the pigments, which are extremely expensive at the time. And so there's no money for art unless it comes from a person that's already rich. In terms of art, we have the development of perspective. This is the first time in the history of art that we have perspective being in place in a two-dimensional space. So we're trying to capture that three-dimensionality of reality, that space that you can see outside a window, and put it into a two-dimensional canvas. So this is a huge departure from what we see in art previously. And again, perspective is going to be key for any single Renaissance art piece. Here we see the School of Athens by Raphael, and we see a clear linear perspective from the back to the front. We're going to be seeing a foreground, a middle ground, and a background. Again, with an emphasis on Greco-Roman architecture, an emphasis on humans, we have an emphasis on key philosophers. Plato and Aristotle are going to be at the center of the piece. The three main features of Italian Renaissance art. You need to remember this because you're going to have an assignment later on. But we're going to be talking about humanism. Again, humanism in terms of showing what it means to be human in the art piece. We're going to see perspective, and we're going to be seeing a lot of Catholicism, sponsored Catholicism within the paintings, because the Catholic Church is patronizing a lot of, it's being the patron of a lot of the artists at the time period. So I'm going to be reading these two excerpts. One of them is from The Book of the Courtier by Baldassare Castiglione, and the other one is a letter from Isabel d'Este. These two excerpts are going to be showing us what it means to be a man and a woman during the Renaissance. Let the man we are seeking be very bold, stern, and always among the first, where the enemy are to be seen, and in every other place gentle, modest, reserved, above all the things avoiding ostentation, and that impudent self-praise by which men ever excite hatred and disgust in all who hear them. I would have him more than passingly accomplished in letters, at least in those studies that are called the humanities, and conversant not only in the Latin language but with the Greek, for the sake of the many different things that have been admirably written therein. Let him be well versed in the poets, and not less in the orators and historians, and also proficient in writing verse and prose. So we see a very well-rounded Renaissance man. They are bold and stern and always the first. They are competitive and ambitious. They know multiple languages and they know multiple fields. Now let's read about the Renaissance woman. To Master Leonardo da Vinci, the painter. Hearing that you are settled at Florence, we have begun to hope that our cherished desire to obtain a work by your hand might be at length realized. When you were in the city and drew our portrait in carbon, you promised us that you would someday paint it in colors. But because this would be almost impossible since you are unable to come here, we beg you to keep your promise by converting our portrait into another figure, which would be still more acceptable to us. That is to say, a youthful Christ of 12 years, executed with all that sweetness and charm of atmosphere, which is a peculiar excellence of your art. So in this sense, we see how the woman wants to be transformed into this Christ, and they have to follow all those Christian traditions, and they're very subjugated by those traditions. And so we see a clear difference between what it means to be a Renaissance man and a very submissive Renaissance woman. Now, when we talk about language back in the Middle Ages, everything is going to be written in Latin. We have the first time where Latin is not going to be the standard. We're going to be seeing the rise of vernacular language. Vernacular stands for public. It is popular. So Latin was a standard of writing until the Renaissance, when native or vernacular language becomes popular. And so we're going to be seeing writing in German, writing in Italian, writing in Greek, and that type of writing is going to be key to actually passing down that knowledge that the church had kept and giving it to a larger population. Again, the spread of ideas is going to be more prominent during the Renaissance. Now, a key political figure is going to be Machiavelli. In terms of writing, he's going to be writing The Prince, and he is the founder of political science. In his book, he's going to be talking about the guidelines on how to be a good ruler, and he's going to be basically separating what it means to govern and the morality of a person. And so a person needs to govern, and a person needs to be, he could be evil in order to govern, while as an individual, they might be a good person either way. So we have this double entendre of a lion and a fox. You have to have the strength of a lion. You have to be cunning as a fox. So you have to have that strength and that ambition to become a ruler during that time. Otherwise, if you're nice, you're not going to have the respect of the population. Here's a short video on Niccolò Machiavelli.
We're often appalled by how sly and dishonest many politicians are, but we shouldn't be. In moods like this, we need to remember and read the works of Niccolò Machiavelli, a late 15th century political advisor and political theorist who argued that we shouldn't think that politicians are immoral and simply bad for lying and dissembling and maneuvering. A good politician, in Machiavelli's remarkable view, isn't one who is friendly and honest and kind. It's someone, however occasionally dark and underhand they might be, who knows how to defend, enrich, and bring honor to the state.
Right, so we get a really, really short description of what it means to be a prince in Machiavellian terms. He's also going to come up with this idea of the ends justify the means. So as long as you're ruling correctly, you can do whatever you please. Now, the Renaissance not only stays in Italy, it moves northwards towards the rest of Europe. And so we're going to be talking about the Northern Renaissance. This is the Renaissance that is happening in the region of Flanders. It's happening in the region of Germany, and it's happening in the coastal regions of Northern Europe as well. The Italian Renaissance spreads to Northern Europe at the hands of monarchs seeking to sponsor art and merchants traveling to and from the Italian hub. So the culture of Italy is going to be spreading across all of Europe. Here's a map of the Northern Renaissance. We're going to be seeing it flourish in England, in France, in Germany, in the Netherlands, in Flanders, and in Denmark. There are some key features for Northern Renaissance art. We have to take into account that they do not have patrons. So they're going to be painting things on their own. Their patrons are going to be people who are rich, who are living their lives as they are. They're not church officials, they're not sponsoring church frescoes, they're sponsoring paintings for their houses. So yes, we're going to be having a focus on humanism, what it means to be human, what it means to relate to each other. But we're also going to be seeing a large focus on nature and a large focus on daily life. Especially still lifes are going to be really prominent across the Northern Renaissance, but also a lot of portraits of people doing daily activities. Northern humanists were more interested than Italians in religious reform and education laity. Basically, we're going to be seeing the rise of Protestantism later on. But again, this is because the Northern Renaissance people were more prone to talking about individuals and having that individual connection with God, because the role of the church is not that prominent up north. It's prominent in Italy, but not elsewhere in Europe. Erasmus is going to be a key figure for the Northern humanist. He said that it's generally accepted privilege of theologians to stretch the heavens, that is the scriptures, like tanners with a hide. This means that he doesn't necessarily understand the ambition of those church officials from the Italian Renaissance, but rather he looks for that humanistic understanding of religion, a more individualized understanding of the scriptures of the Bible and of your relationship with God. Now, other key figures during this time are going to be Thomas More. He writes a book called Utopia, and this is a key term for this chapter. Utopia is a description of an imagined place or a state of things in which everything is perfect. But the term utopia doesn't exist. So we have this notion of something that is ideal and something that is Renaissance-like because it's almost perfect. But we're never going to be seeing that utopia because, again, it doesn't exist. It's a fictional ideal of perfection. Another key piece of literature during the time is going to be The City of Ladies. This is a book by Christine de Pizan. She is one of the first feminists in the history of humanity. She is one of the first to question the different treatment between genders. Her book outlines equal education for both men and women, and she herself was privileged enough to actually have gotten an education herself. So Christine de Pizan is going to be one of the first feminist women that are going to be fighting for equal education. Now, when we move more north, we're going to be encountering the English, and during this time, we're going to be calling it the Elizabethan Age. It's going to happen from 1558 to 1603. The Northern Renaissance in England happens much later than the Italian Renaissance and the Northern Renaissance in Flanders. The Northern Renaissance is translated into Shakespearean and Elizabethan culture. It is called the Golden Age of English Humanistic Literature, and we're going to be seeing that reflected in the work of Shakespeare. And Elizabeth was key in the unification of what we know as British culture. Now, William Shakespeare is also another key figure during the time. There's a lot of key figures during this time because, again, it's a renaissance. Everybody's trying to be the best version of themselves. And William Shakespeare is considered the greatest playwright of all time. He epitomizes those Renaissance ideologies and Renaissance humanism. We see that reflected in Romeo and Juliet. In Romeo and Juliet, we also see those city-states and the way that Machiavellian politics are going to play in Italy. We see the humanism in Macbeth and in Hamlet and in Othello. The question to be or not to be speaks for that humanism, to that speaks of that curiosity of understanding what it is to actually be human, what it is to actually feel human. Now, because we're writing a lot of things, we need to make sure that those things spread across the world. The first people who do this are the Chinese with their printing press. It is invented around 1045. And they use carved characters on a wooden block, and then they ink the block, and then they printed it on paper. The founder of the Chinese printing press is going to be Bi Sheng, who makes a movable type to print each page. It took a long time to actually print a page because you had to input every single character and either carve it onto a block or put it into a specific part of the block in order to actually print the page. Now, the person who revolutionizes the printing press in Europe is going to be Gutenberg. Around 1440, Johann Gutenberg in Germany develops a printing press that combines all the technologies available at the time in order to print. And the first ever book that is printed is the Gutenberg Bible. It's a huge Bible. You're going to see it in a second. Here's a quick video, just a quick chill video that is going to be helping us understand what Gutenberg did. All right, we get a general sense of it. It's just a funny way of reminding us who Gutenberg is and what he did. Now, this is what the Bible looks like. There's only 49 exemplaries of the Bible existing today. Most of them are owned by the state of Germany, and others you can see them at university libraries across the United States. Now, the artistic legacy of the Renaissance is going to be that of Greco-Roman revival. Again, we see that notion of Greek and Roman beauty brought back to Renaissance times. We see a focus on realism and naturalism, trying to paint things, trying to capture things the way they are. We see a lot of secular art, meaning that it's art that is not religious at all. A lot of still lifes in the Northern Renaissance, a lot of daily activities being painted onto those canvases, again, mostly in the Northern Renaissance. We see the rise of vernacular language, popular language and writing. And artists are praised for individual achievements. However, we still see that system of patronage across the Italian Renaissance. So the artists are praised for their achievements, but again, people are paying them to actually paint specific things. They do not have artistic liberty to do whatever they want. The social legacy of the Renaissance is that of having printing allows us to have more access to knowledge. Having printing allows us to expand on education and make education better as well. We have a lot of written discoveries, maps, and charts being created at this time. Again, later on, this is going to be transferring over to the age of discovery. We see field-specific improvements, written laws. The prince is an example of how to manage those laws. And we see Christian humanistic norms about a good life. Again, what it is to be a good Christian, what it means to die and go to hell or go to heaven, and how it is that you have to behave with other authorities during that time period. And there's also a lot of questioning of political and other institutions as well. We're going to be seeing that with the Reformation, how they question the entire structure of the church, of the Catholic Church. So the Reformation. The Reformation is going to be happening specifically in Germany at the hands of Martin Luther. Let's continue with it.
The Protestant Reformation of the 16th century shook the very foundation of Europe's cultural identity. The Reformation was a revolution of religion in Western Europe. Essentially, it was the result of centuries' worth of political and social grievances against the Christian Church as it existed. Christianity, which began as a fledgling religion in the first century, had grown by the 13th century into an institution powerful enough to rival state governments. For instance, the Pope, then the leader of the Christian Church, had greater political and military influence than some emperors and kings. This tension was exacerbated by the transformative social and intellectual period known as the Renaissance. In particular, this period involved the rise of humanism, a philosophy that shifted man's fate from being determined by religious doctrine to being determined by man himself. Additionally, some within the church believed it had become increasingly corrupt. Priests like John Wycliffe of England and Jan Hus of Bohemia challenged the church's teachings, which they believed had strayed away from the Bible. However, one of the most well-known advocates for a reformed Christian church was a German priest named Martin Luther. Martin Luther began to question the church in the early 1500s. He believed it was abusing its power and disagreed with some of its practices. For instance, he challenged the church's doctrine that stated the Pope, not the Bible, was the ultimate spiritual authority. Plus, he criticized the church for selling indulgences, the practice of purchasing forgiveness for one's sins by giving money to the church. Luther believed the church needed to revise its doctrine by returning to the Bible's teachings and by saying that salvation could be granted by faith in Christ alone. So on October 31st, 1517, Luther took a stand. In what's considered the birth of the Protestant Reformation, Luther is said to have nailed 95 theses, or arguments against the church, onto the door of Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany. Luther was later put on trial in front of church officials to defend his theses, but in January 1521, the church declared Luther a heretic and excommunicated him. While Luther's membership with the church ended, the Reformation he argued for started to gain momentum. Unlike Luther's predecessors who challenged the church, Luther had one tool at his disposal that they didn't have: the printing press. This new invention allowed his arguments to be copied and spread across Europe. This unprecedented access to ideas such as Luther's inspired many others to challenge the church, thereby splitting Christianity into two major denominations, Catholic and Protestant, from the word protest. Also, the Bible became more accessible. Luther and other reformists translated biblical text from Latin, which was only known by nobility and church officials, to German, English, and French, languages spoken by the general public. While the Protestant Reformation revolutionized the Christian faith, it had ramifications that extended beyond religion. Prior to the Reformation, many Europeans were dependent on an educated upper class. But perhaps the most resounding impact of the Reformation was that the common people were empowered to question religion and other aspects of life. The Reformation,
along with technological innovations and the introduction of other new ideas, gave many in Europe's general public the freedom and power to decide their own fates.
So let's talk about the causes of the Reformation. Socially, the Renaissance values of humanism and secularism led people to question the church, and also we have the printing press helping spread ideas across Europe. Again, the historical background for the Reformation is going to be everything that happens during the Renaissance. Politically, powerful monarchs are challenging the church as the supreme power in Europe. They want to become independent from the church because, again, if you are a part of the Roman Catholic Church, the highest power is going to be the Pope. Many leaders view the Pope as a foreign ruler and challenged his authority. Economically, European princes and kings were jealous of the church's wealth. Merchants and others resented having to pay taxes to the church. And in terms of religious costs, some church leaders had become worldly and corrupt, and many people found that the church practices, such as the sale of indulgences, was unacceptable. We'll talk about these terms in a second. Now, indulgences. Indulgences are basically small pieces of writing that allow you to have a free pass to heaven. At this time, the church is actually playing on this concept of fear. On the left, we see an image of a church atrium. This is the entrance of the church, and we see a clear distinction between the people who are going to hell, which is a reality for them, and the people that are going to be going to heaven. Again, a lot of people are seeing suffering, and imagine being a peasant at that time period and just having this world constructed around the idea of demons and hell, and having to see it every time you go to church, which is most every day, because that's the only source of knowledge and source of routine that you have in your life. And so you're definitely going to be buying these indulgences, and you're spending all your money in these indulgences to be able to get to heaven. It's like a royal pardon, per se. John Tyndale was an indulgence preacher who traveled around Europe selling indulgences for the Catholic Church. This was one of the causes, again, for the Reformation.
Sleepless night, not for a week, but for all eternity. Are we to be spared the fires of damnation on the judgment day? Tonight, your Pope, the Vicar of Christ, sends you a gift to save you from such fires. Special indulgence granted for the building of St. Peter's Church in Rome, where the bones of the apostles lie moldering.
So I see, here we see a clear example of how fear is used as a tool to coerce people into doing the church's biddings. Here they're asking people to actually help out with the building of St. Petersburg, and they're going to be getting an indulgence not to go to hell if they do so. They're not getting paid, they're not getting food, they're just doing work for an indulgence, this safeguard from going to hell. Now, Martin Luther changed it all because he had really specific teachings about what faith is and what your relationship with God should be. People can win salvation only by faith in God's gift of forgiveness. If you follow religion as it is written in the Bible and you believe in that and you believe in God and you have that relationship, then you're going to go to heaven. All church teaching should be clearly passed on, should be clearly based on the words of the Bible. Both the Pope and the church traditions are false authority. So right now they're claiming that the church and the Pope are switching around the words of the Bible in order to take advantage of the people when the words of the Bible are specific and you have to just follow them. That's the ideology of Martin Luther. And finally, all people with faith were equal. People do not need priests to interpret the Bible for them, but a single person can interpret the Bible by themselves. Now, there were a lot of repercussions. The first thing that happened is that Pope Leo X decrees that Luther gets excommunicated from the church. He's not a part of the church anymore, and he becomes an outlaw. So he has to hide from the Holy Roman Emperor. Charles V issues the Edict of Worms, which declares Luther an outlaw and a heretic. However, Prince Frederick, the Wise of Saxony, disobeys the emperor and shelters Luther, so we see a split into the politics of the time. Luther translates the Old Testament into German so that it's more widely known, it's more widely accepted, and from that translation and from his 99 theses and from his teachings, we have a new religious branch called Lutheranism. Now, because of Lutheranism, a lot of peasants start reading this and start questioning if the authority that they're following is an actual good authority to follow. And in 1524, a lot of German peasants demanded an end to serfdom, and they were doing so by following Lutheranism because they thought that they could rule themselves per se. And Luther, however, asked the princes to intervene. He did not want to get involved with those peasant revolts, and over 100,000 people were killed at the hands of the nobles. The northern Protestant princes supported Lutheranism and sought independence from Charles V. Again, the Holy Roman Emperor was not necessarily a part of the northern Renaissance, and his rule was not necessarily very broad in terms of its scope in Europe. So we had two different sites, a Protestant site and a Catholic side, and they start fighting each other. And so the Holy Roman Emperor asked his subjects to join forces and sign an agreement, and those who didn't want to sign the agreement were called Protestant. The wars between the princes and Charles V end at the Peace of Augsburg. They go to war from 1547 to 1555, and at the end, Charles V gives up, and he decides each prince would decide the religion of their state. However, because they're states that are really close together, that is going to be the cause of conflict later on. Now, here's just a quick background of the division of Christianity. We do have the early Christian church founded by Jesus. However, when we have the separation between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church at the hands of the Byzantine Empire, we call it the East-West Schism in 1054. Now, moving forward a couple of centuries, during the 16th century, we have the Reformation. So we have the split into Roman Catholicism and Protestantism. And in the East, we still have the Eastern Orthodoxy Church. Now, from Protestantism, we're going to be seeing three main branches. Lutheranism, which is going to be beginning with Martin Luther. Anglicanism, which is Protestant England. And Calvinism, which is going to be Protestant France and Switzerland. Now, this is how the spread of Protestantism goes. We see Luther in Wittenberg moving towards Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, towards the Flanders and the Holy Roman Empire, towards Austria, and towards Poland and Lithuania. We see the Calvinists moving from Geneva over to the Swiss Confederation, over to Spain, over to France, over to Scotland, and to Flanders as well. And the Anglicans are going to begin in London, and they're going to be spreading across England. So let's start with the English Reformation. The English Reformation comes at the hands of King Henry VIII, who really wants a son. So the first thing that happens is that he marries Catherine of Aragon, and they have Mary, but that's not a son. So he decides to marry another person, and the way to do that is either getting an annulment from the Pope or somebody dying. There's no divorces at the time. So he has to change the religious structure of England, of the church, in order to be able to stop being in a marriage with Catherine of Aragon and be able to marry Anne Boleyn. Now, King Henry VIII is successful in changing that, and so he marries Anne Boleyn, and they have Elizabeth I, and then decides that Anne Boleyn is not enough, kills her, and then he marries Jane Seymour, and they have Edward VII. Now, we have his son. However, Jane Seymour is not enough, and she gets killed, and we have a fourth wife, Anne of Cleves, and then a fifth wife, Catherine Howard, and then a sixth wife, Catherine Parr. So he was definitely a player, as we call a man like that today, with multiple wives, but just because he wants a son. And this striving for a son is going to be changing the entire religious structure of England. And so Henry VIII, after having a daughter, asked for an annulment. He wants a boy, and the Catholic Pope refused the annulment. So he calls for Parliament to make him the head of the Protestant Church and calls for his divorce. This is called the Act of Supremacy. The Parliament passes that act, and he finally is able to get divorced and marry again. Now, we have three offspring from Henry VIII. The first one is going to be Edward. He's considered the first Protestant ruler, but he took power at the age of 8, and he got really ill at the age of 15. So we had to get another person to rule because he was not fit to rule. So Mary, Queen of Scots, comes in. She tries to reform the church again and make it Catholic again. However, it doesn't really work out, so she has to flee to Scotland. And so we have the rise of a second Protestant ruler, Queen Elizabeth I, and she is the Elizabeth that we talked about with the Renaissance fulfilling its promise in England after the Protestant Revolution comes. So the Renaissance comes after the Protestant Revolution in England, however, it comes beforehand in the rest of Europe. This is because Elizabeth was really keen in creating that unified culture that I have talked about. Elizabeth also decides to establish her own state church. It's going to be called the Anglican Church, and it's going to be a church that is going to be perfect for a moderate Catholic and a moderate Protestant. For the Protestants, priests are allowed to marry. That's a big win for the priests. And for the Catholics, they really like their luxury, so they're going to be allowed to still wear those rich robes and to have that money that the Catholic Church likes to hoard. Now, moving geographically, we're going to be talking about the Swiss Reformation. The Swiss Reformation is created by John Calvin. He is one of Luther's French followers. And John Calvin promotes the unique ideas about the relationship between people and God. He publishes so in Institutes of the Christian Religion. And basically, he says that only a few people are chosen to be saved. Everybody's born with sin, but God already knows who's going to be saved and who's not going to be saved. This is called predestination, the doctrine in which God has known since the beginning of time who will be saved. So this is a really, really specific ideology that Calvinists are going to be following, and that's going to be separating them from the rest of the church as well. Now, Calvin believed in a government controlled by religious leaders. He wanted a theocracy. And in 1541, he actually achieves this by becoming the Protestant leader of Switzerland. However, this begins a lot of moral oppression. If you're not Protestant in Switzerland, then you're going to get excommunicated. You're going to get imprisoned. You're going to get killed. You're going to get banned from the country itself. Now, John Knox is going to be meeting Calvin in Switzerland, and he's going to be going back to Scotland and establishing his own type of religion. This is going to be called the Presbyterians. And so these group, led by John Knox, are going to be deposing Mary Queen of Scots in favor of her son James. Because Mary Queen of Scots was a Catholic, and they did not want a Catholic ruler. They wanted a Calvinist ruler. That's why they try to instill those ideologies into his son James. But that never happened because Elizabeth I took power over both England and Scotland. Some other Protestant reformers are going to be the French Huguenots. They basically instilled religious violence against the Catholics, and there was a lot of fights between them and the Catholics in France. And they also had the Anabaptists. These are specific. They have a really specific ideology. They believe that even though you're baptized and you already have that process done within the Catholic Church, if you join them, you have to be re-baptized in order to actually be following the getting the original sin that I was not washed off from Catholicism, washed off by the Anabaptists. They also wanted the separation of church and state. So again, all these different key features are going to be played around with the different subsections of the religion that is being created in terms of Protestant religions. And the Anabaptists were the precursors for modern-day Mennonites, Amish, Quakers, and Baptists. We see similar religions being in place today across the United States. Now, finally, we're going to be talking about the Catholic Reformation, or as we call it, the Counter-Reformation. This was initiated to address the effects of the Protestant Reformation. It was a comprehensive effort composed of apologetic and polemical documents, and also the church reconfiguration as decreed by the Council of Trent. So we have a lot of reconfiguration within the church, and also the creation of new subdivisions of the Catholic Church itself. So the first subdivision and the most important one is going to be the Jesuits. Ignatius of Loyola from Spain writes a book about spiritual and physical exercise. It's called Spiritual Exercise, and he does a lot of meditation. And so all these exercises and all that learning are going to be cleansing his soul, and it's going to be allowing him to reach heaven. His followers made the Pope create the Society of Jesus, and now we know them as Jesuits. El Colegio Ibero is a Jesuit school, for example. They have three main Jesuit activities. The first one is schooling and education. They're going to be creating schools across Europe and later on in the colonies of those European powers. They're going to be trying to convert non-Christians to Catholicism. That's the point of education. They're going to be instilling that religious education in a worldly education as well. And they're going to be trying to stop the spread of Protestantism. That's the main focus. So it's like a legion of Christ that is going across Europe, both educationally and religiously, to stop the spread of Protestantism. Now, the first pope that establishes some papal reforms to the church is going to be Pope Paul III. He starts investigating indulgences and abuses within the church. He approves the Jesuits. He starts the Inquisition, and we see the Inquisition play a huge toll not only in those colonial powers, but also in the colonies later on. They kill everybody who's not, or trial everybody who doesn't follow the religion as they see fit. And he also organized the Council of Trent, which I'm going to talk about in the next slide. The Council of Trent is a group of church officials that come together from 1545 to 1563 to establish some specific guidelines. The first guideline is that the church's interpretation of the Bible is final. Nobody else is going to interpret the Bible for them because they are the Catholic Church. The second one is that Christians need faith and work for salvation. It's not just your relationship with God that's going to actually help you get to heaven, but you actually have to work for it. The Bible and the church are equally powerful authorities. You cannot undermine one or the other. And they actually say that indulgences are valid expressions of faith. So indulgences actually still happen today. If you pray a full rosary with a group of people and with a priest, you might get an indulgence as well. You might also, you don't necessarily buy those indulgences, but you can convince a priest to give you one. Now, the papal reforms, the second wave of papal reforms are after the Council of Trent. Pope Paul IV is going to be carrying out all the decrees of the Council of Trent, and is going to be burning all the books across Europe that do not match with the church's teaching. So anything that has to do with Luther, anything that has to do with Protestantism, and anything that has to do with any other religion that is not Catholicism. Now, let's ask ourselves, how did the Reformation change European daily life? During the 15th century, religious city life was based on the clergy. We have a huge structure of power in terms of the church. Daily life is regulated by the church calendar. You have fasts, you have ceremonies, you have to go to church every Sunday, otherwise you're going to be prosecuted, or persecuted rather. There's going to be monasteries and nunneries as influential institutions across Europe, and even many Catholic clergy had concubines and children and were often resented by lay people. So basically the church did whatever they wanted. During the 16th century, there were far fewer clergy. We don't have a lot of priests because, again, we see a lot of crumbling of the infrastructure of the church. We see the same aristocratic families ruling over the same specific cities. The number of holidays shrunk by one third. Again, we see more of an individualized way of life for a lot of people. The cloisters had nearly disappeared. Church services were conducted in vernacular languages. Beforehand, most church services were conducted in Latin, even during the colonies. And Protestant clergy were still resented by the masses. Now, the legacy of the Reformation. We're finalizing this presentation. Now, there's going to be some religious and social effects. There's going to be a religious war being waged until the Treaty of Westphalia in 1647, a religious war between Protestant princes and Catholic princes across Europe. We see the rise of Protestantism. Again, it's huge, huge, because the church is losing its power. But we also see the unification of the Catholic Church. We see a very united front from them, especially with the Council of Trent. And we see a little bit of improvement in the status of women reformers. We talked about Christine de Pisan. And we do have some Protestant women reformers, but they still do not get the same power as their male counterparts. In terms of political effects, we're going to be seeing the decline of Catholic moral and political authorities. We're going to be seeing a lot of secularization. And with this secularization, we see the rise of the modern nation state. We're going to be seeing that focus on becoming the best country in the world, having the most resources, having the most property, having the most land, having the most people to control over, and being able to rule over the most territory. So again, this is going to give rise to the age of exploration. So thank you so much. That's it for the presentation on the Reformation and the Renaissance. Have a great night.